Overnight, Dunkin's Pumpkin Spice Coffee has sent folks into a cozy craze. I'm Lauren LaTulip, reporting live from home in my hand-knit turtleneck that my Nana made me. Mmm, cinnamony.
The home with Dunkin' is where you want to be.
This episode is brought to you by Experian. Are you paying for subscriptions you don't use, but can't find the time or energy to cancel them? Experian could cancel unwanted subscriptions for you, saving you an average of $270 per year and plenty of time. Download the Experian app. Results will vary. Not all subscriptions are eligible. Savings are not guaranteed. Paid membership with connected payment account required.
Since you've been gone,
since you've been gone,
I feel like I've been chewing on tin foil. Since you've been gone, it's like I got.
Matt, we are back with another episode of Weird Algorithm, and we are talking about Al tackling some like acapella doo-wop here. Mm-hmm. And we are joined by one of my personal favorite reoccurring guests of ours, the delightful Kelly Phillips. The funny thing is that I grabbed my copy of Weird Me and I was combing through it like, why did we tell Kelly she had to do this since you've been gone episode? And it wasn't until I combed through the book two times that I remembered, oh, wait, she did animation for a different book.
Yeah.
Where she did since you've been gone.
I say nothing about it in my book.
So, Kelly, I have to start with that. With the since you've been gone thing, like, did you get to choose what song you wanted to animate, or were you assigned an animation for that book?
Yeah, so when the book got announced, I then got reached out to by the editors at Z2, asking if I would contribute to the illustrated Al, and they gave me a short list to choose from. I remember my thought process at the time was I had a pretty short deadline for when I needed to get my comic into them, so I was going to choose the shortest song possible. And there is nary a song shorter than Since You've Been Gone. But it is also one of my favorites. I think it has, and I'm sure we'll talk about this more, I think one of my favorite punchlines of any song that Al's done.
Yeah.
And it's just so simple and sweet that I was like, yep, that's the one for me.
And I love that it just continues this weird track record that we have of, with the exception of you picking Don't Wear Those Shoes, we've essentially just assigned you episodes ever since.
I'm here for it. Keep the thought process out of my book.
I also like, I would imagine this is a fun song to animate because it's just right. It's all right there, right? It's just like,
yeah,
it's just like,
the process
you're just,
of this was, yeah. It was an interesting process because I hadn't had to adapt a song before.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really, and the only assignment that we were given was that it needed to be an adaptation of the song as presented. So you weren't really trying to like build a story involving it and using it as narration. It was really just adapt the song as a comic. So
right.
I had to sit down and just kind of really pour through every line of it to say, you know, there's a lot of very graphic imagery provided.
Yes.
Boy,
in
is
this
there.
Song, which is extremely helpful for me as the cartoonist. But I had to, you know, kind of pick and choose what exactly it was that I would need to depict and kind of weave through it to present it as more of a visual narrative. And the fun dilemma that leaves me with was then I'm just getting to draw torture porn, essentially, of Al and just all of the different ways that I can mutilate him. So I was really cackling to myself the whole way through, just envisioning all the ways that I could draw him getting maimed.
Right. Exactly. Yes. Al,
I also
loves
had to give myself
to
kind of like a before and after Al to be like, this is how he starts and this is what he's going to end up looking like after all of the torture. And just
yeah.
use that as my guide.
Oh, God. Yeah. No, Al loves to inflict serious carnage on himself. He really does.
Yeah.
He
is
does
a,
it
a
in
masochist.
Detail.
Oh, yeah.
So I have a lengthy email I need to read early Ooh. On in this episode. So
oh,
for
boy.
People who pay attention to our podcast and the mailbags, you may remember that we got an email from someone who was asking to be the guest on this episode, a listener named Harley, because they had insight on Barbershop.
Oh, yes.
We had already agreed, though, that Kelly was going to be the guest on this. So I said, please send us some information. I will read what you send us.
And I feel like I've usurped an expert.
Well,
my expert is only in visual torture.
So this is the email Harley sent. He said, hello, Mats. Once again, this is Harley coming back at you so much. Thank you so much for reading my last message on the mailbag and for inviting me to share how much Al has impacted the world of barbershop harmony. First, I want to mention that I'm a member of the Hershey chapter of the Barbershop Harmony Society.
Oh,
formerly
wow.
known. I love this. A second. Formerly known as the SPEBSQSA Incorporated, or the Society for the Preservation and Encouragement of Barbershop Quartets Singing in America Incorporated.
Wow.
That is very thorough and succinct.
I sing with a chorus called the Parkside Harmony, a contemporary barbershop chorus. The community is such a joy and has recently implemented a wonderful mission of everyone in harmony, now with treble and mixed choruses. Barbershop has been doing the art of parody for quite some time now, which makes Barbershop a musical cousin to Al's work, not only with parody, but also with being a pop culture staple, being featured in Disney World or in The Simpsons episode Homer's Barbershop Quartet, or even in video games like Cuphead and Bioshock. These are just a handful of examples, but also, in a sense, Barbershop ensembles have become cover groups, inserting their four-part harmonies with any dominant seventh chord all over popular songs of any given era. Just how Al is, in some way, an artist dedicated to mimicry and style in imitations and parody with his own spin. Much like Barbershop taking hits and changes in the style of Barbershop, Al takes hits and changes in the style of polka. Once Al came along, it changed the face for Barbershop. For those listening who are unaware, the BHS has an international convention every year. At the convention, there are workshops, hallway singing, and at the center of it all, an international singing competition for choruses and quartets. It's a great time for some great music. The best choruses and the quartets all come together to share their work, and there we see some of the greatest influences of Al.
I'm going to need to know the level of drama that happens at this conference.
Oh.
On a level of, like, pitch perfect to, I don't know, just like furry cons, you know?
That's what I'm hoping. I'm hoping that it gets real. There's that the book that Pitch Perfect is based on covers the whole world of collegiate acapella and how crazy it is. So he sent a bunch of links. We can look at that later. But I do love that one of the band's names is Shoptimus Prime, which is just top tier.
If you're not making a pun in your acapella group name, you don't really understand what fun is.
Why are you there?
What's the point? Come
guys?
On, guys.
He said some sets that come to mind that parody movies in a pre-existing song, such as the gold-winning New Tradition have set by dressing like Star Trek characters or the Marx Brothers or Shoptimus Prime. One of my favorite international Weird Al-inspired moments was when the Music City Chorus won the competition and presented a swan set where they did a Weird Al barbershop polka medley to make fun of the fact that they won. They can use instruments now, despite it being against the competition rules. It's complete with an ear poker tag at the end. And then he sent us a link to that, which is awesome. And I'll insert some of that in there. In addition to those aforementioned moments, there have also been times where quartets have just covered Al songs at barbershop conventions. Good Enough for Now was performed multiple times. And the Electric Barber Cats have performed Stop Forwarding That Crap to Me and a parody of Don't Download This Song about the monotony of getting songs approved for the contest through copyright procedures. One More Minute has also become a popular song among quartets to cover, and The Buzz, the 2005 International Sweet All Deans Champions, did a parody about how much they hate each other after competing together after all these years. So needless to say, not only were barbershoppers inspired by Al's parodies, it has come full circle, and now barbershoppers are parodying Al. One more barbershop-related thing that I'd like to mention is that Al has a pre-generated birthday message that you can get sent to your friends, and in the message is a barbershop quartet singing his song Happy Birthday.
Yes.
Thank you so much for allowing me to share all this as a lifelong barbershopper and all-time Al fan. It's awesome to really observe these two passions as they cross paths. In my eyes, the two are so closely related that when I saw him live in 2022 in Lancaster, PA, seeing the Yoda chant live made me think, man, Al and his band would have been a great barbershop ensemble. Thanks to all the wonderful podcasts that you share the love of Al with so many people. Want to leave you with a question. If you could pick one Al song that could be barbershopped, what would it be? My personal choice is This Is the Life.
Ooh, yeah, that makes sense.
That would be good.
That's
a cool stylistically, one. Too. That's very in the oeuvre.
But I was like, I can't even skip any elements of this email because this is like just filled to the gills with interesting information that I never really thought about. And also just love a shout out to that Simpsons barbershop episode, which is one of my
B-sharps.
My absolute favorite song in the history of Simpsons is Baby on Board. I love
Baby on Board.
That song so much.
I also just love getting a firsthand glimpse into a subculture that I'm previously unaware of.
Yeah.
Because now I'm invested. Now I want to know, like, who are the rivalries? What are all the team names?
Idea of barbershop rivalries immediately just made I want to watch a 8-hour Netflix documentary about this.
I need a documentary about this. Please have it happen in Hershey, PA, because then I can drive there.
Yeah, exactly.
No, listen, I'm already saying right now, I'm going to get more information from Harley because he's clearly in our little East Coast circle.
Yep.
And if there is a local convention to Pennsylvania and they love Al as much as they do, I don't see why the three of us can't do a live episode of Weird Algorithm at the barbershop competition.
Hershey's not that far. My folks actually just moved out that way, so I'm ready to go.
Officially, that's exciting.
A month ago.
They did, yeah. Yeah, there you go. See?
But yeah, so I'm trying to think of his question as well, because, man, there are... I'm like looking at his originals. Based on... I mean, I feel like the easy ones, like he said, like One More Minute, This Is the Life makes sense. I think any of the acoustic songs work. I want to go with something a little bit weirder.
I know, yeah.
It's an early song that I have championed for a really long time, and it's already got a bit of a vaudeville vibe. Checks in the Mail. I think Checks in the Mail as a barbershop song would be fantastic.
That also checks out. That's a good,
That plays stylistically, absolutely.
I also stylistically maybe would be fun to do like Christmas at Ground Zero.
Ooh,
I can hear that.
You could do that as kind of a Christmas carol.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that could be fun.
Yeah, no, I want something like that does not lend itself to a cappella very well. Like, you need like It's All About the Pentiums or something.
Yes.
Ooh, the truck driving song maybe.
Ooh, that would be fun. Yeah, really give Al and the band a challenge.
Yeah, and really, like, if you're going to have to use Steve for the deep bass, I want that's going to force him into his deepest register.
Which he does on this track. This track is basically Al and Steve. Steve providing the low voices in the mix. Al performed most of the vocals himself. And to make sure he stayed on key, they did record a scratch guitar track that was mixed and then removed before everything was said and done. This is just a really, like, I feel like as we've been talking about Bad Hair Day, the listeners are getting this journey of me becoming an Al fan through this album.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, like,
was this your first album?
This is my first album, yeah. So, like, I knew Amish Paradise, and like I said, I didn't know how to feel about the first couple tracks as a kid. Alternative Polka really, like, hooked me in. And this, right in between this and Gump, like, this felt like when I got to this track, like you said, and we'll get there, the punchline to this track really, like, helps solidify what Al is. Like,
yep.
And like, I believe that by the time I got to the second side of the cassette tape, I fully grasped, like, what I was diving into was going to be more than just... this guy changes the lyrics to songs to make them funny, but that there is a much more sadistic, dark, fucked up side to him that was going to be the part that lasted for a lifetime. Like the parodies, I think, hold enjoyment over time, and then it slowly fades the more you hear it because you get used to the jokes.
Mm-hmm.
But stuff like Since You've Been Gone is just, like, still is funny to me 20 years
later. Totally agree. Yeah, this punchline, and it's rare to have a song that, you know, and it can only happen because the song is so short, I think, but to have the punchline be the final line of the song.
Yeah.
Because the rest of it is just kind of like, oh man, this is like, that's a little extreme, isn't it?
Yeah.
But then you get it with the final line. But yeah, I agree with you. I can laugh at this song every time I hear it.
Totally.
It is always funny to me to hit that landing.
Yeah. Well, and let's go through the lyrics really quick. And you can tell us about all the fun things you had to animate as we go through.
I know, I'm like pulling up my script that I had to put together for myself, which is usually like my own thoughts and words. So I was like, what am I actually scripting here? But it was, you know, all the ways that Al was going to be tormented.
Yeah. So he said, since you've been gone, I feel like I've been chewing on tin foil.
I have to stop right away because we've talked before about how Al, I think everyone's mileage will vary on something like this, but how it's, he, like, you know, like you up the ante constantly throughout the song and you keep elevating it. This is a real, for me, this, he might actually start with the worst one.
You're starting at a 10.
That immediately makes, like, I shudder. at that phrase. It is.
And I don't like the next line. Since you've been gone, it's like I've got a great big mouthful of cod liver oil.
I mean, that sounds not great, but I would do that over tinfoil in a second.
Like a momentary displeasure.
Yeah.
Although it's probably going to like coat your mouth.
Yeah, your whole mouth's going to taste like that for hours.
The thought of tinfoil is actually making me like wince right now.
if you have fillings in your mouth, there's a thing where if you actually have fillings from cavities and you chew on tinfoil, there's like a phenomenon that occurs where you literally get like a shock in your mouth. Like it will give you a mild like electric shock from the two touching each other.
This is nightmare. What we're losing. It's a nightmare.
Don't do this.
All right. That's our lesson from today.
So I'm starting. I just have to point out we are starting from a 10.
Yeah, we should measure which ones exceed chewing on tinfoil.
Oh my God. Right. I don't know if they will. We're going to check, but both for me. Oh boy.
He says he feels like he stuck his hand inside a blender and turned it on.
Okay, that's pretty bad.
Because he's been in a buttload of pain since he's been gone.
Yeah. I hope you're using your non-dominant hand because it's gone.
Yeah.
It's gone.
That is, I think of as a fan of horror movies, there are definitely things that always don't sit well with me. And seeing like any appendage get like getting something lobbed off is one thing. It's the
the
blender idea, the mutilate. Like, I think the loudest I've screamed at anything, and I'm not going to go into the details of it, but if you've seen the movie Green Room, there is a scene involving a person's arm and a machete that literally had me like scream when they showed it. Like, that's where like my line is a lot of the time.
I had to wrestle with myself on this one because I was like, I'm definitely drawing him putting his hand into a blender. But when I was coloring it, I remember really debating with myself what color like the goop needed to be.
Yeah.
Because that was really going to escalate the level of violence that it was depicting if I made it like pinkish or bluish or something. Like, it was just going to read very differently depending on the color. So I had to really make sure it wasn't like too grotesque.
Yeah. What color did you land on eventually?
I think it's kind of a like smoothie, peachy kind of color.
More flesh than blood leaning almost.
The blood hasn't quite mixed all the way in.
I've been in a buttload of pain since you've been gone.
Side note, just love the use of the term buttload as well. Yeah. That's just it's you don't hear that used that often. And just for him to just say, and you're like with all the voices together, the been in a buttload, like, I don't know, describing anything as a buttload is just going to be funny. It's just,
I'm with you because it's kind of like so benign that it becomes funnier.
Well, that's what I mean. I was going to say it almost undersells how horrific everything he's described is.
Yeah, just being like oh, this is a buttload right
pain.
Now.
Yeah.
And they're making you look at the little smiley face pain chart. And you're like, where's a buttload on
here?
On a scale of 1 to 10, what would a buttload be?
I feel like would be like a 3. Like, it seems pretty low in my brain.
I feel like it would be higher than that, but it's also like...
It's like a persistent pain.
Exactly.
But it's not the worst pain.
Well, he says he couldn't feel any worse if you dropped a two-ton bowling ball on his toes.
Yeah.
Pretty bad.
That's very bad. Heavy. That's a very heavy bowling ball.
You're losing a foot at that point. Yeah. That's not coming out of there.
And it couldn't hurt any more if you shoved a red-hot cactus up my nose. I would put that above the 10 on the pain
scale. I agree. I think depending on the size of the cactus, and I went with a huge one.
I was going to say, I feel like this is the one where you get the most artistic... leeway on.
I think that was my favorite panel to draw too, because I really had to figure it out.
There's a lot of.
I think that ranks higher than tinfoil.
I think you might be right. There's a lot of physics to reckon with on that one. Just trying to wrap your head around the whole thing. I mean, it didn't have to be even red hot. Even if it wasn't red hot, it would be pretty bad.
You're right. It's two levels of pain.
It's extra,
it's both the heat, and the physical. Deformity that's going on, and then it's also going to be the little pricklers are going to stick behind.
It's tough.
There's nothing like pulling one out. Oof. You know.
Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing. You shove it up there, it also has
the
to come back
process.
Out later.
Oh boy.
Everything's bad in that one.
Hey, it's Kaylee Cuoco for Priceline. Ready to go to your happy place for a happy price? Well, why didn't you say so? Just download the Priceline app right now and save up to 60% on hotels. So whether it's Cousin Kevin's Kazoo Concert in Kansas City, go Kevin! Or Becky's Bachelorette Bash in Bermuda, you never have to miss a trip ever again. So download the Priceline app today. Your savings are waiting.
Go to your happy place for a happy price. Go to your happy price, Priceline.
My dad works in B2B marketing. He came by my school for career day and said he was a big ROAS man. Then he told everyone how much he loved calculating his return on ad spend. My friends still laugh at me to this day.
Not everyone gets B2B, but with LinkedIn, you'll be able to reach people who do. Get a $100 credit on your next ad campaign. Go to linkedin.com/results to claim your credit. That's linkedin.com/results. Terms and conditions apply. LinkedIn, the place to be.
Hello everyone, we're Superhero Stuff You Should Know, and if you think you know about superheroes and comic books, think again.
We got romance, we got action,
romance.
We got comedy, we got everything you need, man. Come on down to Superhero Stuff You Should Know for all your superhero needs.
I don't know about this romance, what part are you talking about?
We've got all kinds of sketches, and then deep dives on top of that. Come on down to Superhero Stuff You Should Know.
Alright, so come on down to, why did I say come on down? To Superhero Stuff You Should Know.
I actually feel like the wrap-up, it gets much less awful. Like, it's not... Like, in comparison to everything we've gone through, when we get to, it feels like I'm getting a tetanus shot every day. Like, not great, but, like, I'll take a tetanus shot every day over a cactus in my nose.
That's what I was just going to say. Like, it's been a few, I'm actually probably, some real fun medical information for everyone. I think I'm due for my tetanus booster, so I have to get that soon.
Better do it.
But I don't remember it being, like, a particularly unpleasant
shot,
right?
I almost feel like if you wanted to...
Maybe.
If I would say, like, if you said it feels like I'm getting a rabies shot every day, like, that's the one that I hear is just, like, nightmare. I've never gotten
that's
one,
also
thank
like,
God.
Like an injection schedule.
Yeah.
Whereas
like,
tetanus is
yeah.
a one and done. I will say, though, I had a bad tetanus shot experience once in my life, so I'm permanently traumatized by them, even
tell,
though I did get
tell
my booster.
Tell Matt about it to prepare him for that booster.
There we go.
Yeah. Yeah, there was, I think it was when I was 19 or so, I went in and was getting my tetanus booster. And the next day, it inflamed to, like, a disc-sized welt. Like, this is, like, three inches of a welt.
Whoa.
And it was, like, burning hot. I was feeling really, really bad. And I also, like, my eyeball was, like gritty, goopy shut. Like,
whoa.
I could barely open my eyeball. So we go back to the doctor just to be like, what happened? That's not normal. This shouldn't be happening. A very unhelpful nurse just kind of like leaned across the desk and told me that this is a normal reaction and sent me home.
Ooh.
But I had gotten pink eye because in some way related to getting this tetanus shot. No idea how or why, or just maybe this doctor's office was a gross experience.
Matt, save that tetanus shot for after Comic-Con, please.
Jesus.
But when I got my booster a couple years ago, no problem.
No problem. Okay. All right. Well, thank you for putting that on at the very end there for me. I appreciate that.
But yeah, no, that welt lives in my mind forever. That was really bad.
If I had
but
a terrible...
I think they just given it to me poorly because, you know, like sometimes if it like...
That does happen,
gets right under your skin or something. So I don't know. This doc, I don't go there anymore. They sucked.
Yeah, boo.
Put them on blast.
Hometown doctor's office.
Since you've been gone, it's like I've got an ice cream headache that won't go away. I mean, that's pretty bad. I'm not a fan of an ice cream headache.
Yeah, I mean, compared to some of the other things, it feels benign, but that also would be a pretty unpleasant. That's a tough way to live.
If this is lasting more than a few seconds, I might just end it all.
I just imagine, like, there are those days where I wake up and it's like bad allergies mixed with a million other things where you just have that migraine here.
Yeah.
And I just imagine, like, oh, if that was just every day for the rest of my life. Not working. And then we get to the punchline. Ever since the day you've left me, I've been so miserable, my dear. I feel almost as bad as I did when you were still here. And the harmonies and the extra, like, woo! It's a perfect ending.
Perfect ending. And it really is, like, an amazing thing because I feel like on paper, in every way, this feels like an interlude, right? It's so short. It's over so fast. And it kind of whips by, which almost makes it seem like a throwaway in a way. But it's so not. I feel like this is, like, almost like a center point of this album to me.
Yeah.
Like, this is a real big, big moment on the record, and it lands so well. I totally agree, Kelly. Like, because it's so short, he gets to put the punchline at the end in a way that, like, the whole song, it's funny and it's enjoyable up to that point, but then the way that he can land that ending is just, it's great. A rare opportunity.
A level of restraint there, because you could have extended this kind of song concept to a full-length song, but you'd only be able to make that joke once.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, like, you could make it leading into, you know, like, your first chorus or whatever, and then you kind of just reiterate all the ways that this sucks.
Yeah.
But you're going to have to keep coming back to that, and then, you know, it would kind of wear out. Whereas this, it's just, like, a perfect little amuse-bouche.
Yeah. Yes. I looked up, like, references for this, you know, as, like, a style parody. And, of course, it says Barbershop. And that there's a few artists, like, noted or, like, comparisons. Billy Joel comes up with. Yeah. But I was listening to this, and I remembered in prep for this episode. Do you guys remember the group Rockapella?
Yeah, from Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego?
Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego?
Yes!
They also did a series of commercials for Folgers Coffee.
Yep. The best part awakened.
But this was a 90s thing. Like, this must have been on Al's radar when he did this. Because Rockapella were this, like, what a bizarre moment in time that this, like, five-person a cappella group actually had success and performed on TV shows.
A literal world stage.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I feel like now it's going to be this real moment in time thing, but for people of the right age, Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego was one of the biggest kids shows. It was so popular. Everybody I knew watched that show.
One of life's regrets will be being a little too young to try out for Carmen Sandiego. Yeah.
Boy, what is a dream, like, to get on that show.
And bring it back.
Oh, I know. It was so good. But then these guys had actual other success. They were, like, I looked into it. They were featured in, like, a Spike Lee, like, a cappella special that he made.
Whoa.
And they do a song called Zombie Jamboree, which is based on a Harry Belafonte track from, like, but, like, a weird, like, it makes total sense. Like, it's this, like, the walking the line of, like, super talented and also, like, kind of a novelty thing. Like, I can totally imagine Al just seeing that and being like, oh, this is something I want to, like, try my own
hand
at.
That was one of my questions. It was like, I get this song. I love this song. But why?
Why?
Well,
why this song and why then?
Yeah. Here's what my argument is going to be. I honestly, truly believe that in the way that, like, musical styles always come back around, I think that there will never be a point where, as much as it's kind of mocked as lame, that, like, a cappella stuff will always be fascinating to watch. Because when I was in college, I was the head of, like, I was the student event coordinator. So I worked directly with the event coordinator at the school for booking, like, what live music would be there, what musicians, what magicians, anything that we could do, because it was a commuter campus, anything to get people to stay on campus. And year after year, it was always the a cappella group that filled out the, like, activity centers for people to watch. And, like, I remember one of the groups, I have all of their albums. I've followed their career since they played at our college. They were a group called Chapter 6, and they were they won a Grammy for they did a, I guess, going back to what Harley was talking about with, like, the Al-isms, they recorded this 5-minute song called Wizard of Oz, where through a cappella, they tell the entire plot of the Wizard of Oz, covering every single song in this medley. And, like, they won, like, an arrangement Grammy for it. Like, they were just like, this is incredible that they did this. But I think, like you said, Billy Joel, like, Billy Joel in the 80s was like, let's do an album that's a throwback to this doo-wop a cappella Motown sound. Like, people keep coming back to this idea that with no instruments but five people who really can control their range, you can create a catchy song. And I mean, again, think about doing a show like Where in the World is Carmen Sandiego. Like, you don't have to worry about instruments or anything. You just bring these five guys there and they can create the entire score for you right there live on stage. Like, I get why it keeps coming back, and I think at this point in Al's career, he's probably already witnessed two different times where this style of music has popped back up. So, like, why not finally just do it?
Yeah, it's a strange thing because it's got, like, it's so immediately impressive. Like, when you see it and hear it, and again, I meant to mention this earlier, but, like, go on YouTube right now and search for Weird Al Since You've Been Gone. You will find loads of a cappella groups doing it over the years, like on stages at shows. And yeah. also, of course, now loads of people doing the just multiple cameras, filming themselves at home, yeah. singing yep. every vocal part, all the heads lined up in a row.
That
tons and tons and tons of people. Because it's just a great, like if you're a singer, it's,
yeah, it's like no barrier to entry.
Exactly.
You know?
And, exactly.
And also, I mean, Al is clearly a bit of a Disney geek as mm-hmm. well. Just like between like throwing the Haunted Mansion song into the Yoda chant and obviously doing a song like Skipper Dan. So I'm sure that there is a love that he has of the Dipper Dans, the like barbershop quartet yeah. that roams all the Disney parks doing barbershop songs.
Yes. Totally.
So I'm sure that there was just this thing where he was like, my entire life, this style of music has been unescapable. It's instantly recognizable. Why wouldn't I do it as a style
yeah,
parody?
It has like, multiple novelty factors because it's, yeah. It's a throwback.
Yep.
Which is always like something that people will be charmed by. Mm-hmm. It does require a lot of talent. Like there, mm-hmm. you can't just kind of improvise yeah. a good a cappella arrangement, mm-hmm. you know, with all yeah. the different parts of harmony in that. But then I think to the point that Harley was bringing up, there's a lot of like covers and parodies
yeah.
and just the entertainment value of hearing a song that you are familiar with presented in a different way is just always going to have novelty
yeah.
factor. So it doesn't surprise me at all that that's, you know, like especially at a college campus where people are just into like quirky and original things, like that's something that would be perennially
totally
amusing.
I don't know how this got on my radar beyond the fact that, as we've said a million times, I just love to dive into different genres of music. But did either of you ever discover the group Emo Cappella?
Oh, God, no.
Which in the 2000s, it was in a college a cappella group. I want to say they were based in like New England that exclusively just did pop punk and emo MySpace songs. So they did like
wow.
Cute Without the E as an a cappella song. They did like
wow.
Even Hitler Had a Girlfriend by Mr. T Experience. Like they would just find the most over the top yeah. brooding heartbreak pop punk songs and do them as these cheery a cappella songs. And it was in that same vein of what he like the same way that Al takes these depressing songs. We just talked about alternative polka last week,
mm-hmm.
taking these dour, depressing, angsty songs and making them sound so happy with polka. Emo cappella did the same thing with taking these like brand
yeah,
new and taking
it has
back
that air of like sweetness
yeah.
to it.
Yeah. And there's also just something like Al loves to, and this goes back to the alternative polka as well. And this is like, this is not a dig at a cappella music at all. I don't want it to come across that way, but
oh,
it
he's
is like
coming for a cappella music.
It is, well, I was going to say it's both really impressive and also kind of like inherently uncool.
Oh, absolutely.
You know what I mean? Which is it's the perfect sweet spot for Al, right? Where he can have
yes.
so much fun with it for that. Because it's uncool, he can lean into it in his own way and then perform it and flail his arms around while singing this like
yes.
really impressive thing. It's just exactly where he wants to be.
Well, I think,
and I think
that
it's uncool in that way that it's like earnest.
Yes.
Because
well,
exactly.
you have to try really hard.
Because it's so
to make
hard.
It good.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Well, I think that was what half the comedy of the first Pitch Perfect movie even was.
Mm-hmm.
Was this idea that a school would exist where a cappella was the biggest thing.
Yeah.
And that
yeah.
everyone just accepted that is cool is just
yes.
so outrageous.
Yeah.
Like, because
I love
that would
when we
be
all
like
just collectively accept that we are being presented with an alternate reality.
Yeah.
It's like, yes, in this world, a cappella is the most important
the
thing.
The most important thing. It's totally, yeah.
yeah. I fully accept, move on.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah. I don't know if you guys saw, this is another one. He, Al reappeared on Regis and Kathy Lee and performed this song live
oh,
for the audience.
Did he forget the words this time
as
well?
He did not forget the words. Last time we saw him on Regis and Kathy Lee, he completely blanked on Icky Breaky's song and had to be stopped.
You know what?
Poor guy.
Not a crime.
No. So he got up there and it's like the backing track is, you know, all the extra voices are on a backing track and he's just singing the lead live. And he does a great job. And once again, it is this like hilarious, I swear to God, I encourage anyone, like, go on YouTube and look up footage of him on that show, because Regis and Kathy Lee both love him and have no idea how to talk to him about anything he does. Like, it is so, and so they make a joke. They were like, so what, he finishes the song, and they're basically like, so what was that? You wrote that?
Like he, oh my God.
And he was like, yeah, you know, and of course him joking, he's like, well, you know, yes, I do a lot of parodies, but also I write occasionally, I write very straight ahead, very serious love songs. And that was one of those. And then Kathy Lee goes like, well, from where we were sitting, we couldn't understand any of the words, but I'm sure they were very moving.
Oh my God.
And he just goes, okay.
I still think my favorite answer he's ever given in an entire interview was the Regis and Kathy Lee interview, when Regis is like, anybody does anything successful, you're just there making fun of them. And he just, there's like a beat and he goes, well, it makes me laugh.
Yeah, exactly. And then the other thing from that that's fun, and we're not there yet, but Al does also say to them, he mentions that he gave them a shout out in Syndicated Incorporated.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
They seemed pretty pleased with that.
There you go.
So it was very sweet, but I just like, it's so funny. Like they clearly love him and they just don't get it.
They don't relate to this at all.
And they're like, he's fun. He's again, like I love Kathy Lee. He's like, what a kooky guy. Like she just like loves to say that sort of stuff. And Al's a great sport, of course, about all of that.
And I'm sure if they don't recognize the song, they're like, what does that mean?
I can only imagine them for like the minute and a half, the two of them sitting there going like, do you know, recognize this? I have no idea what this is.
Yeah, like, is this some old doo-wop song from when we were
this
children?
Doesn't sound like Amish Paradise to me.
Julio was really branching
out. Yeah, exactly.
I think that he was really proud of this song because we saw that he performed it on the Much Music special as well.
Yes.
He performed it on Regis and Kathy Lee. I am almost positive he also does a performance of it for the Al TV that we're gonna do after Bad Hair Day.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure, I mean, you both of you have seen Al an astronomically more amount of times than I have with my one. But I'm pretty sure this is a song that still shows up in Al's live shows all the way until now because it's just a fun thing to do.
Yeah, I was wondering that actually going in, whether this had been performed live. And I assume on the Bad Hair tour, it probably was performed. I didn't look into it.
So incredibly,
so I ask this now.
Yeah, and I'm surprised to say that he actually did not. He did do this a bunch when the album came out. He has not done it since 1997, which means they didn't do it for the Vanity Tour, which is really surprising to me.
Wow.
Now,
that is surprising.
I looked up footage, and we know, I mean, you literally just referenced, like, the Yoda chant. Like, we know that he and his band can do these sorts of things, but in all the clips that I saw, it's like he did it on Regis and Kathy Lee, where he's singing lead, but the extra voices are canned. It's Al's track from the record. And maybe
that's why he doesn't want to do it anymore or
perhaps,
something.
And maybe they just didn't have enough. Maybe those guys together couldn't quite fill it out enough to
get all those ranges.
Exactly,
yeah.
Exactly. Like, it might have just been, with just those guys on stage, maybe it didn't feel big enough.
You know,
to do
it would be
justice
fun.
To.
Do you remember when Ben Folds did his college a cappella album?
I don't know if I know,
do you know
about
this.
I might
not. The last time I thought about Ben Folds.
So Ben, this was, God, this may have been 15 years ago now. It was a long time ago. But some college group had recorded them doing an a cappella version of his Bitches Ain't Shit cover.
Sure.
And he and he loved it so much that he did a contest where he was like, college a cappella groups, cover my songs, email them to me, and he picked like his 20 favorites and flew them out to his studio and released this album.
Oh, that's so
of
cool.
Him singing lead while they did the backup vocals, and then he hit all of their colleges and their a cappella group opened for Ben Folds at the colleges.
Oh, that's awesome, actually.
But I'm like, I feel like Al could very easily, if he's playing like near a college, just be like, hey, send me your college a cappella group and we'll do Since You've Been Gone like during the show. That would be so much fun.
Like he did with Strings Attached, actually. That's a cool way to do it. I totally agree. I just want to point out,
because it's definitely like very high on my list of, because I had to make a list at some point. I had to catalog every song I have seen live. That's very close to the top of my list of ones I want to see live.
Agreed, yeah. On the Bad Hair Day tour, that thing I was just describing with him with the track, that was the show opener. He opened every show on that tour, it looks like every show, with Since You've Been Gone, and then, as it is on the album, went right into Gump after that. Like, the band came out, and then they played Gump.
Oh, that's an awesome start to the show. I love that.
Yeah.
I love that.
But he has not done it since the 90s. So
bring it back, Al.
I know,
this is
right?
My formal request.
Exactly.
Yeah. Please do it.
Let's make it happen.
I'll help you. Whatever you need.
Yep.
Yeah, you can have your animations behind him.
Yeah.
Just on a projector.
Hey, I'll sing one of the parts. I'll sing a high part.
We
Come
got
on.
It. We
Let's
got
do it,
it, guys.
All right. Well, I think we've hit that time where we can rank this one. And ooh, Matt,
this is the stressful part.
I know. This is where it gets stressful.
That's why I need a notepad.
I actually think I'm kind of shocked at how high I'm putting this.
Ooh.
But I think comparatively, you can compare this to One More Minute. And I think I like this one more than One More Minute, which seems crazy. I don't like it more than This Is the Life. I really like This Is the Life. So I'm putting it, it's in my top 10 right now.
Wow.
In between You Make Me and Dog Eat Dog. I'm pretty sure it's in my top 10. Yep, it's number 9 in my top 10. So that's where I'm putting Since You've Been Gone on the original Al song.
That's really, really high placement. I love that. I'm not going to go that high. But I'm definitely doing it. It's like the upper middle of my list here. And I'm going to put it in between Christmas at Ground Zero and Velvet Elvis.
All right.
That's
perfectly in the middle, really.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of. I think it's, the upper mids. No, I really do love this one. Again, like I said, especially considering it on paper seems like it could just be this like toss throwaway song, and it's just, it's really not. It lands so great.
All right, and Kelly, now you get to have the stress. First off, where are you putting Since You've Been Gone?
Hang on, I'm full screening this. I gotta really
dive in.
I mean, you can tell me right now if you need me to bring you closer to the top with Since You've Been Gone, at least.
Okay, this is definitely a favorite of mine.
All right, so we'll go to the top. We'll start from the top working down.
This is a mixed list of every, okay.
We can only apologize for the guest rankings.
Yeah. Oh, man. We're all going to fight it out one day.
I can't wait.
Wow. Okay. Some of these are very surprising. I always love seeing the chaos of where this has landed.
Yeah. Maybe that's what we're really building to on this show is an episode like where all of our guests just duke it out.
Yeah.
Some of these are so low now. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Because I'm also thinking ahead to which one I'm going to move.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Okay, let me think. Well, if we're looking at the top of this list, and I consider this pretty high
top tier
list.
Yeah.
This is top tier. I'm going to get creative. I'm going to place this between One More Minute and You Make Me.
Okay.
Because I think we're putting the two kind of spiritual love songs together then.
Mm-hmm.
I like that. One More Minute is it's a really good reference point for this track. It's funny because they don't have that much in common, and yet they actually do feel like, I mean, they're both like,
They're cousins.
Yeah. They're love songs that as about as sincere as Al can be, at least up to this point in his career.
Yeah. Yes.
And now the big game is where you're going to move something.
Boy, okay, so now I need to see which songs are actually causing me pain that they're low on the list. And I think I already saw the one that I'm going to move, but now I'm just being thorough. All right, all of these are okay with me. These are all in solid places. All right, I think I need to move Nature Trail to Hell. Way up the list. I don't know who left it down there. I'm going to place it. Goodness gracious. Let's put it. This is going to be bold.
Do it.
Ooh, how bold am I being? We're going to put it below Everything You Know Is Wrong.
Okay.
Perfect.
I have to call this out.
I knew you were going to say.
Last week's guest literally said, well, Nature Trail to Hell is way too low, but someone else will take care of that for me. And
I swear, last week, which, you know what? We'll pull the curtain back even further for our listeners here. Last week's episode, which we recorded seconds before we started with you, he literally just said, he's like, you know what? I know someone else is going to take care of Nature Trail to Hell. We'll be fine.
I'm here for cleanup.
Done deal. Yeah. That's amazing.
Well, now I got to know, which one did they move over Nature Trail to Hell?
They bumped Slime Creatures from very low
into
the
creatures.
Top 10.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I respect that getting a little love.
Yeah.
I got it. Basically, what he said was, if this is the only time I'm on the show, I'm sure that the reoccurring guests will take care of the big ones. I want to take my passion one.
Yes.
He thought that was a song that might not get as much.
It would not get as much attention.
Good strategy. So, it worked out. It paid off. He nailed it.
Yeah.
Respect. I'm glad we could inadvertently team up on
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
Well. Kelly,
Before we do the wrap up, I want to give one quick shout out for this song. I mentioned how I searched for it, and it's loads and loads of acapella covers of this track over the years. And I thought to myself, I'm like, I wonder if anyone has done a cover of this song that didn't do it acapella and actually added instruments and made a track.
There is a version of it.
I found one. I don't know if it's the same guy, a guy named D.A. Stern.
Yeah, D.A. Stern put out a double EP. It was Since You've Been Gone was one half of it, and the other half was he did You Don't Love Me Anymore.
That's right.
As like, how would you describe it? It's almost just like a lo-fi, like, rock song.
Yeah, like a synth pop.
Yes.
I mean,
that's where my brain went. I was like, you got to do it as like a synth pop or a synth wave.
Yeah,
because
it was just like, since you've been gone.
But like, yeah, padded
like
synth
a little
stuff,
drum
like,
beat
drum
in the background and stuff. Oh, it's so
really
good.
Really good. Highly recommend it. Shout out. I don't know him at all. I think I saw he's based out of L.A. D.A. Stern, Since You've Been Gone. Super, super good. Shout out. I mean, a lot of really great versions of it online. You can hear loads of great covers of this song, but that one really stood out to me, so shout out.
Since you've been gone, well, I feel like I've been chewing on tin foil. Since you've been gone.
Kelly, is there anywhere that people can go to see what you're up to? Any new works that you're working on? Do you have anything that you want to promote that's coming on the horizon?
Yeah. So people can find me at my website, kellyphillips.net. They can also find me wherever on socials at Kelly P Comics. And that's where you'll see me post any new projects that I'm working on, any comics shows that I'll be exhibiting at. I'll be at quite a few throughout the fall and the winter. And we're trying to also travel a bit more away from the East Coast, so maybe I'll run into people I haven't gotten to see yet before.
Nice.
Yeah, and otherwise, I am working on a lot of things, unfortunately, at the same time. So hopefully I've got some new fun projects for you all to see in a few months. And they're all going to be building on each other towards what is ideally going to be my dumbest project of all time.
Yay!
Oh, wow, what a teaser. I love that. That's great.
Yes.
All right, and we will be back next week to talk about Academy Award-winning movies.
I feel almost as bad as I did when you were still here.
You're listening to the Geekscape Network.